I like to play around with this. I'm going to show you a little clip here because I talk about sometimes the bedrock elements of not only how you get a unified team, but our experience in aviation. And there's a clip I want to show you. First, I want to say, though, that individual ownership is probably another area that we give too short shrift to. We say we want you to own things. I talked about in my book, Southwest Airlines. How many of you in here are familiar with Southwest? Just about everybody? Okay, anybody have a son or a daughter or somebody in your family working for Southwest? Every now and then I'll see a hand. Southwest does something amazing. They put people through a five-day training course when they come aboard. 5 days. I mean, not everybody can afford to do this. Certainly most hospitals can't afford to do this. But what they do in that five-day period of time is take people from the position of being a new employee to the position that on Friday at 5, before you go off to have a party, you aren't an employee anymore. You are Southwest Airlines. It's not a matter of buy-in. It's a matter of having to restrain people from racing over with their new ID to spend a couple of hours in the terminal and do something to help a Southwest customer, because they are so imbued in just 5 days' time with the history and the pride and quite frankly, the fun that they instill in that area, in that airline. I use the word fun advisedly. I know we don't really know that word very well. I come from an Air Force background. We took all our regulations and put them into computers not too many years ago. And somebody, of course, had to do a search. And they found out in 16,500 pages of Air Force regulations, which we now esoterically call instructions, there was not one single solitary recitation of the word fun. So we sleep tight tonight. Your Air Force is awake. We're not having fun, but we're awake. Fun is an essential part of enjoying what we do. Fun is an essential part of a camaraderous relationship in which people in an OR, in an ICU, in an ED, in a hospital, on a floor, enjoy being with each other, enjoy working with each other, enjoy the challenges that may keep them on their feet for 12 hours without a meal, but they enjoy it because it is the heart and soul of what they signed up to do. You don't do that in a vacuum. And too many of your people who are not telling you the truth about this because they don't know how and they don't have the methodology are in a very, very deleterious situation in which they are simply hunkered down and trying to get through every day. Yes, some of it's monetary, but a lot of it has to do with their own outlook, their outlook of their profession. And I'm not just talking about nurses. I'm talking about a lot of docs. We've got an awful lot of physicians leaving practices, you know, which is an awful thing, and it's going to get worse over time. We've got a situation in which the government is now inevitably going to have to get involved in primary care because we haven't been able to sort it out with the monetary challenges that we've got. And in all that, we've also got the challenge of trying to figure out how do you make it not just fun, but how do you make it satisfying? Individual ownership is it. A Swedish hospital, Seattle, my wife used to run two floors there of orthopedics years ago. About 2 years ago, there's a lady who's an immigrant from Russia, she can barely speak English, who came onto the floor like so many others in housekeeping and other parts of the hospital and were essentially ignored, except she wasn't ignored. The charge nurse came over and introduced herself, introduced her to the other people on the floor and the nurses, and over the last 3 or 4 months, this lady has really begun to feel a part of the team, even though she can barely speak the language and her job is to sweep the floors and to ready the rooms. I mean, she's not even qualified for sterilization of the rooms. One morning, about 6 a.m., she's all alone on one of the corridors. There's a closed door to one of the rooms. It is not her job to wonder what's going on behind those doors, and yet she hears a rhythmic banging behind one of the doors, and it doesn't sound right. And she goes over and opens the door and finds that there's a lady who's had throat surgery who's eaten a cracker, which she shouldn't have eaten, but she's choking to death. And all she can do is bang on the wall because she can't reach the switch to call the nurse. This lady immediately races down the corridor. She is so flustered, she doesn't know what to say. She's babbling in Russian. Finally, the charge nurse who's saying, Rosa, I don't understand what you're saying. She grabs the charge nurse, pulls her down the hallway, thrusts her into the room. They call a code just in time, and they save the patient. That's one of a million stories. You all have your own. But that's buy-in. That's ownership. That's saying, I am not just a part of Our Lady of Pretty Good Outcomes Hospital. I am this hospital, and I'm proud of it. And instilling that takes a lot more than rhetoric. It takes really figuring out what your people are doing. It takes getting down there in the woodwork and saying, we are going to speak with a common voice. not just to dictate from top down, but to listen from bottom up, we're going to come to common conclusions. We're going to postulate things, and we're going to let you all, we're going to ask you, we're going to beg you, we're going to basically say we can't do it without you, to know how you feel about these. And we want participation. And if you're not going to participate, maybe you'd be better off working someplace else. It has to be that kind of two-way. That's the difficult part of it, but the inspirational part of it is that once you get that dynamic going, oh my God, the information you get, the reality that you see, the bright eyes that come at you and say, you know, I've been thinking for some time we could do this way. Not every suggestion is going to be stellar, you all know that, but very often they are. Very often they'll solve problems that you simply couldn't solve yourself. Nurses, what we've got to do is get rid of the horizontal hostility. We've got to work upon overload and workarounds and lack of faith that anything will ever change. Those are bedrock basics if you're going to get beyond the point you're at now, which is the way we've always done it. You've got to break through that. How do you break through it? You charge all your nurses with getting involved. And you charge them with getting involved to the extent that those who want or those who are going to play games need to go someplace else. And yes, I know there's a shortage. There's a shortage everywhere. Nurses, doctors, but we still, one rancid individual can destroy the morale on a floor. You all know this. And yet we tolerate it at times because it's so difficult to deal with. One doctor who absolutely becomes a maximum resistor can infect and destroy the morale of half the docs on the staff on a particular subject that you're trying to get under control. By the way, a couple of books that I want to recommend to you. One of them is called Inside the Physician Mind by a very, very brilliant guy named Dr. Joe Bujek, B-U-J-E-K. It is a book published by the American College of Healthcare Executives. It's no piker. But Joe does the best job I've ever seen of not just getting inside the physician mind, and there's no pejorative there, he is a physician, but in basically saying we have not only multi-generational challenges, but we also have tremendous challenges in understanding that you cannot lead physicians by consensus. You have to lead by critical mass, and that opens up a whole new bright possibility. It's a good book. It's one that I think you will find very useful. I'm doing my best to assign it to boards these days. And of course, I think my wife's books are also very useful for you nurses in terms of horizontal hostility, but I'm not here to sell books. Basically, what I want to focus you on is the need for participating, the need for having everybody buy in from the lowest to the highest level. And as far as dealing with the tomcats among the doctors for you CMOs, we simply can't do this any longer. I convened under a federal grant a number of years ago a meeting in Dallas at my law school, Southern Methodist, and I won't go through the whole thing, but basically one of the most important elements we got out of that was a battery of very senior plaintiff's attorneys, one of whom was worth $800 million derived in personal wealth from just suing doctors and hospitals, who said, why can't you guys understand this? They're talking to, on the other side, some of the leaders in healthcare like Dr. Lucian Leap and Dr. Nancy Dickey, former head of the AMA. He said, why can't you guys understand that if, for instance, you don't follow best practices, I got you. If you don't apologize, hold their hands and tell them the truth, I got you. If you have a situation in which clearly you should have been following a protocol and you just completely ignored it because your docs were pushing back, you're still a hospital, you're still responsible. Thanks to a decision back in 1965 in Illinois called the Darling decision, a hospital is ultimately responsible for everything its practitioners do, and the board is the responsible element of that.